You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is James Scarborough. I would like to welcome you to session 10 of Art 100. We're going to cover the Renaissance today. If you're of British or other Dominion persuasion, you call it Renaissance. We're live, and that means you can call in with or write with responses to questions of the day. I want to note yet again, if your question doesn't get read on the air, even though they're piling up like planes at LAX, that doesn't mean you won't get credit for them. And you can continue to submit responses to these things until kingdom, well, at least till the term ends. And speaking of term, the country is in the aftermath of a midterm election. We are in the aftermath of a midterm exam. So those of you who have inquired about extra credit points, pay attention. You can submit two questions, that's 2 points a class for the rest of the term, and these little guys will add up. So there you go. Before we go any further, I want to do a shout out. We have a student in Shasta Lake. This student goes to Central Valley High School, and way up north, we have a preference for northern cities. And the high school is Central Valley High School. And their art is supported there by the Shasta County Arts Council. And we'll see a couple of pictures of the building. There's the Arts Center, which is very cool. Old brick building, maybe it was a firehouse, we don't know. But there you go. And just pictures of the building, so there you have it. You guys are asking a lot of questions about exams and about midterms and about assignments and about ArtSite papers. And some of you are asking questions about these things after these things are actually due. And I just want to reiterate or even iterate the fact that there are really 4 ways to see what's going on in this class. You should avail yourself of at least one of them. First, you can watch live on TV and I will announce what's coming up in the next week or two. 2, you can watch the video, the link of which to which I provide you either tonight or the day after tomorrow, or day after today, which is tomorrow. I put little things up in the announcements, and I know you guys get emails that tell you that there's an ArtSite paper coming up, for instance. And it also just sits there nice and cozy in the assignment and exam schedule, in the syllabus, in Blackboard. So there's really no reason for you guys not to know that there's something coming up. So there you have it. Speaking of things coming up, we have an ArtSite paper that's going to be due. It's due on the a minute before midnight, 11:59, on November 18th, which is a Tuesday. And it's 300 to 400 words. And what you have to do is you have to find an actual site of where you can look at art. A gallery, a museum, an art center like we just looked at. There's art in cafes, there's art in restaurants, there's art in craft shops, there's public sculpture, there's interesting architecture, there's graffiti, some of it sanctioned, some of it not. So there's really not a reason that you can't find something to write about, provided, of course, that you start looking for something now. And I'll let you in on a secret. I think that actually, for most of you, finding something to write about will be harder than actually writing the paper. Once you find it, you're going to be excited, and the paper most likely will just flow through. And I got an email a few minutes before going on air. A student had asked, I can't tell if she misunderstood the question, but it was certainly a good angle for the question. She asked if she could find a museum online, like, I don't know, a museum in Russia or I don't know what, but and write an ArtSite paper based on that. And the answer, though it's a clever question, is an emphatic no. It's, I want you guys to get in front of an actual work of art in the specific context in which it's placed, in a inside, outside, as a building, inside a building, on a wall. So there you have that. And we also have 5 days later, because it's a busy October, on Sunday, November 23rd, also a minute before midnight, we have assignment number 4. And that's only 50 words, actually. And I think that's actually a lot of fun, because all that I'm telling you is I want you to describe to me your perfect museum. And as you no doubt have read in the syllabus, all sorts of things that you might not think are museums are actually museums. Did you guys know that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is a museum? Did you know that the Baseball Hall of Fame is a museum? Did you know there's a clown museum in Wisconsin? Did you know, and I kid you not, it's actually an astonishing place. Kohler is a little city in northern Wisconsin. Kohler, I don't know if you know this or not, or have even noticed it. Kohler makes a good number of the toilets in America, and there's a Kohler Toilet Museum, and it's not as gross as it sounds. It's about engineering, and believe it or not, it's about art. There's a lot of stuff. So those are the two assignments coming up, so there you go. Now, because you guys are getting a little bit heavy, you've gone through the midterm, you've got an ArtSite paper, and you have assignment 4, the final assignment before the final exam. Next week, you're supposed to read chapter 17, which covers the 17th and 18th century in Europe, and chapter 18, which is Islamic and African art. We are going to omit chapter 18, though it breaks my heart, because Islamic art and African art are incredibly, incredibly interesting. And I have to be honest, A, it's a ton of reading for you guys, because it's a big chapter, and B, it's an extraordinary amount of information to cover, interesting as it might be. And I would be devoting probably 15 minutes to African art, 15 minutes to Islamic art, and that's just not right. Besides, you guys are busy. So you don't have to read chapter 18 for next week, because I'm confident all of you are caught up on your reading up until today. And as a result, obviously, there will be no questions on the final exam from chapter 18. Let's take a look at the question of the day, the first question of the day. Now, it's kind of a question. Okay, Renaissance means rebirth. We'll get to that in a second. Implying a revival of classical culture. We'll also get to that in a second. How did artists of the Renaissance revive classical art and ideals? How did they move beyond the examples of Greek and Roman art? That's kind of a question. I don't know if you're going to, I mean, you can answer it one of two ways. You can answer it out of your head without really having, well, you've read the chapter, I'm sure. So it's a very interesting question, because the whole thing's fascinating. But the question specifically is, how did they go beyond just copying the ruins of art they found in ancient Greece and ancient Rome? Anyway, that's the first question of the day. Right, call, let's talk. Then finally, because we are just giving you gazillions of opportunities to take a stab at taking a walk, and nobody's done it, so if somebody does it, they're going to be the first one, and it's going to be a monumental occasion. We're going to take a walk with an image by Salvador Dali called Soft Construction with Boiled Beans. Yes, he had crazy titles like that. Premonition of a Civil War. You can't help but notice it's a very tortuous but dynamic scene. These are bones, these are body parts. There's dismembered stuff. You've got the face that's being tortured. Things are held together, but barely. It's very tortured, very dynamic. but it's also a very powerful piece. And yes, some of you might have noticed it's about the Spanish Civil War. And having noticed that, you would also then connect that with another piece we've looked at a couple of times, Picasso's Guernica. So there you go. Let's take a look. What we're going to do now, let's take a look at some prior comments that we get. So I get a ton of stuff during class, emails. And I also get some from over the weekend from you guys. And some of them are just staggering. They're all really good. And I wish I could read them all in length. Burgundy Zorn writes, and this is in response to the question I posed. And I said, is it cool to take things out of tombs, works of art out of tombs, even though they're not works of art? They're funereal things. Can you take stuff out of that and justify it? Taking it out of the country, putting it in an art museum, and totally denuding it of any burial significance. Burgundy writes, I don't really think stealing beautiful and sometimes sacred artifacts from tombs can be justified. Yes, the artwork is amazing and inspiring and opens a gateway for us into the past, but often these tombs or grave sites are those of highly valued and honored ancestors of the culture. Disturbing those tombs should never be done without the consent of those in authority. I also believe that if artifacts are found in burial grounds of a culture, they should be returned to the people for display in their area and not shipped overseas or to another country for display. Very good. Burgundy Zorn is of the opinion, no, you can't do that. So therefore, she presumably would believe that those Elgin marbles, these gorgeous Parthenon sculptures taken from Greece to London in 1811 should be returned. Johnny Caratini wrote, and this is from a couple weeks ago, I talked about if an architect and his client have some sort of, they butt heads, what should you do? Should the architect yield? Should the owner compromise? Johnny Caratini writes, in a very particularly elegant way, I might say, add, I think at the end of the day, the client is paying the architect to do what he or she is good at. But I know a client would not want to pay for something they didn't like. I think it's okay for the architect to suggest, but if the client is adamant, the architect must put his personal artist aside to satisfy the client. Johnny comes down on the side of the owner's rep. Good, thank you. Emmanuel Crawford wrote me a question, and I've said this before. You guys can ask me questions about anything. I mean, you can, out of the blue, you can ask me about being an art critic, about being an art historian, about working in a museum, all sorts of fun stuff like that. Out of the blue, Emmanuel Crawford wrote to me, how has the discovery of art that comes from tombs and other burial grounds had an effect on the art that is created today? That's a superb question. It's a whole course worth, and that's actually the story of art history. If you're studying art history, particularly not just taking a class but studying it, you try to see how things influence everything. And so I wrote back to him. You could say that the art from tombs and other burial grounds has affected all art that's ever been created. Modern art builds from 19th century art, 19th century art builds from 18th century art, and so on. Every once in a while, you get artists like Picasso and Braque, when they invented cubism, to create a new way of seeing. But for the most part, artists work off of what's been done in the past. Even Picasso and Braque we're looking at neoclassical work and tribal work, so they're always looking at something. That's why it's important to have a sense of the art we looked at yesterday, that is, art of the ancient Mediterranean area, not just Greece and Rome, but everything that came before that. It's the basis of everything we see today. I know that's a fuzzy answer, and it is, and I could talk about it forever, but it's true. Nothing comes from nothing. I think that's also part of a Julie Andrews song, but anyway. Okay, so getting on to the topic, last week we talked about we ended with medieval art and a transition to Renaissance art. And we looked at two artists, and we're going to look at them again just for a second. We have a piece by Duccio, an artist named Duccio. Can we see that slide, please? Somewhere, there it is. It's a very simple piece, but you'll notice it shows, it's one of the first pieces that historians have noticed this. You can actually, he's used architecture in his painting. So Christ is on the horse, or maybe it's the donkey, and there's an actual space made by that arch that he's going through. Space is becoming more sophisticated pictorially. The pictures are becoming more visually coherent. And then I believe we concluded with an image by Giotto. Can we see that, please, the image by Giotto? This is a lamentation. We have Christ. We have a very coherent space here. We have a very dynamic diagonal. And you can see that it's not just dynamic. It links the heads of that saint, whoever that would be, that head, these mourners, and Christ itself. So it all comes down to there. It's an incredibly well-organized composition, and that set the stage for what's about to come. I'm going to show a video now. Now, there's a series of videos that I just discovered, and they're from Crash Course. And there's no way you're going to read these like Cliff Notes and get everything you need to know about Renaissance art, about world history, about biology, about calculus and stuff. But what I will say is it's a perfect preview of an introduction of something. And the guy also, it's very interactive. The guy is very edgy and jumpy, so he's definitely going to hold your attention. It's going to go for a little over 10 minutes. That's longer than we normally would show a video, so we're going to break it off after 5 minutes. The first 5 minutes, he's going to give you an introduction to the Renaissance, and it's interesting. And for the most part, it's accurate. He says it's pretty much 100% because of the money that the Renaissance happened in Italy. And that is so absolutely not true, but that's fine because his other points are good. Then we're going to come back, and then I'm going to talk about something that's actually brilliant that he says. So can we run the first 5 minutes of that video, please? It's called The Renaissance. Was it a thing?
Hi, I'm John Green. This is Crash Course World History, and today we're going to talk about something that ought to be more controversial, the Renaissance. So you probably already know about the Renaissance, thanks to the work of noted Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Leonardo, Michelangelo, Donatello, and Raphael, but that isn't the whole story. Mr. Green, what about Splinter? I think he was an architect? Ugh, me from the past, you're such an idiot. Splinter was a painter, sculptor, and an architect. He was quite a Renaissance rat. Right, so the story goes that the Renaissance saw the rebirth of European culture after the miserable Dark Ages, and that it ushered in the modern era of secularism, rationality, and individualism. And those are all on the list of things we like here at Crash Course. Mr. Green, I think you're forgetting Cool Ranch Doritos.
Yeah, fair enough.
Then what's so controversial? Well, the whole idea of a European Renaissance presupposes that Europe was like an island unto itself that was briefly enlightened when the Greeks were ascendant and then lost its way and then rediscovered its former European glory. Furthermore, I'm going to argue that the Renaissance didn't even necessarily happen. But first, let's assume that it did. Essentially, the Renaissance was an efflorescence of arts, primarily visual, but also to a lesser extent literary, and ideas in Europe that coincided with the rediscovery of Roman and Greek culture. It's easiest to see this in terms of visual art. Renaissance art tends to feature a focus on the human form, somewhat idealized, as Roman and especially Greek art had. And this classicizing is also rather apparent in the architecture of the Renaissance, which featured all sorts of Greek columns and triangular pediments and Roman arches and domes. In fact, looking at a Renaissance building, you might even be able to fool yourself into thinking you're looking at an actual Greek building if you sort of squint and ignore the fact that Greek buildings tend to be, you know, ruins. In addition to rediscovering, that is, copying Greek and Roman art, the Renaissance saw the rediscovery of Greek and Roman writings and their ideas. And that opened up a whole new world for scholars. Well, not a new world, actually, since the texts were more than 1,000 years old. But you know what I mean. The scholars who examined, translated, and commented upon these writings were called humanists, which can be a little bit of a confusing term because it implies that they were concerned with, you know, humans rather than, say, the religious world. Which can add to the common but totally incorrect assumption that Renaissance writers and artists and scholars were, like, secretly not religious. That's a favorite area of speculation on the internet and in Dan Brown novels, but the truth is that Renaissance artists were religious. As evidence, let me present you with the fact that they painted the Madonna over and over and over and over and over and Stan! Anyway, all humanism means is that these scholars studied what were called the humanities, literature, philosophy, history. Today, of course, these areas of study are known as the so-called dark arts. What? Liberal arts? Oh, Stan, you're always making history less fun. I want to be a professor of the dark arts.
A dark arts job. It's a dangerous position.
Yeah, I guess that's true. So we'll stick with this. Right, so here at Crash Course, we try not to focus too much on dates, but if I'm going to convince you that the Renaissance didn't actually happen, I should probably tell you, you know, when it didn't happen. So traditionally, the Renaissance is associated with the 15th and 16th centuries. Ish. The Renaissance happened all across Europe, but we're gonna focus on Italy because I want to and I own the video camera. Plus, Italy really spawned the Renaissance. What was it about Italy that lent itself to Renaissancing? Was it the wine, the olives, the pasta, the plumbers, the relative permissiveness when it comes to the moral lassitude of their leaders? Well, let's go to the thought bubble. Italy was primed for Renaissance for exactly one reason: money. A society has to be super rich to support artists and elaborate building projects and to feed scholars who translate and comment on thousand-year-old documents, and the Italian city-states were very wealthy for two reasons. First, many city-states were mini-industrial powerhouses, each specializing in a particular industrial product, like Florence made cloth, Milan made arms. Second, the cities of Venice and Genoa got stinking rich from trade. Genoa turned out a fair number of top-notch sailors, like, for instance, Christopher Columbus, but the Venetians became the richest city-state of all. As you'll remember from the Crusades, the Venetians were expert sailors, shipbuilders, and merchants, and as you'll remember from our discussions of Indian Ocean trade, they also had figured out ways to trade with Islamic empires, including the biggest economic power in the region, the Ottomans. Without trading with the Islamic world, especially in pepper, Venice couldn't have afforded all those painters, nor would they have had money to pay for the incredibly fancy clothes they put on to pose for their fancy portraits. The clothes, the paint, the painters, enough food to get a double chin, all of that was paid for with money from trade with the Ottomans. I know I talk a lot about trade, but that's because it's so incredibly awesome, and it really does bind the world together. And while trade can lead to conflicts, on balance, it has been responsible for more peaceful contacts than violent ones because, you know, death is bad for business. This was certainly the case in the Eastern Mediterranean, where the periods of trade-based diplomacy were longer and more frequent than periods of war, even though all we ever talk about is war because it's very dramatic, which is why.
Anyway, that's a good history lesson, actually. And I think if you watch more than 5 minutes in one session, it's like eating too much sugar. But anyway, he gives some really good information. He talks about why Italy itself was one of the centers of the Renaissance, because it was trade, and specifically trade with the Ottoman Empire, but it wasn't just the money. But he's trying to be clever, and he's trying to say, was the Renaissance a thing? And usually, I'm not trying to be a critic here, I'm just saying, he's actually trying to be hip, but he's actually making a far more clever point than I believe that he's actually making. So we're gonna finish with the rest of the video. It's another about 5 minutes and 20 seconds, and then we'll come back. And the point basically that he's gonna make is, and I wanted to keep it, well, he tells it glibly, but it's a brilliant point. Artists, people in the Renaissance were not aware that they were living in the Renaissance. They weren't like saying, oh, mathematics, oh, astronomy, oh, Greek ruins. There was the 99% of the people, it didn't matter one bean of difference to their lives. And then the 1% were the wealthy patrons and the artists. And he's going to say that in a pretty funny way. So if we could finish that video, please. Thank you.
Called Assassin's Creed, not some Venetian guys negotiate a trade treaty. Thanks, Thought Bubble. So here's another example of non-Europeans supporting the Renaissance. The Venetians exported textiles to the Ottomans. They were usually woven in other cities like Florence, and the reason Florentine textiles were so valuable is because their color remained vibrant. That was because they were dyed with a chemical called alum, which was primarily found in Anatolia in the Ottoman Empire. So to make the textiles the Ottomans craved, the Italians needed Ottoman alum, at least until 1460, when Giovanni de Castro, Pope Pius II's godson, discovered alum in Italy, in Tolfa. And he wrote to his godfather, the Pope, "Today, I bring you victory over the Turk. Every year they wring from the Christians more than 300,000 ducats for the alum with which we dye wool various colors, but I have found seven mountains so rich in this material that they could supply seven worlds. If you will give orders to engage workmen, build furnaces, and smelt the ore, you will provide all Europe with alum, and the Turk will lose all his profits. Instead, they will accrue to you." So the Pope was like, heck yeah! More importantly, he granted a monopoly on the mining rights of alum to a particular Florentine family. The Medicis. You know, the ones you always see painted. But vitally, Italian alum mines didn't bring victory over the Turks or cause them to lose all their profits, just as mining and drilling at home never obviate the need for trade. Okay, one last way the Islamic world helped to create the European Renaissance, if indeed it happened. The Muslim world was the source of many of the writings that Renaissance scholars studied. For centuries, Muslim scholars have been working their way through ancient Greek writings, especially Ptolemy and Aristotle, who, despite being consistently wrong about everything, managed to be the jumping-off point for thinking both in the Christian and Muslim worlds. And the fall of Constantinople in 1453 helped further spread Greek ideas because Byzantine scholars fled for Italy, taking their books with them, so we have the Ottomans to thank for that, too! And even after it became a Muslim capital, Istanbul was still like the number one destination for book nerds searching for ancient Greek texts. Plus, if we stretch our definition of Renaissance thought to include scientific thought, there is a definite case to be made that Muslim scholars influenced Copernicus, arguably the Renaissance's greatest mind. Oh, it's time for the open letter? An open letter to Copernicus. But first, let's see what's in the secret compartment today. Wow! The heliocentric solar system? Cool! Earth in the middle! Sun in the middle! Earth in the middle! Sun in the middle! Ptolemy! Copernicus! Ptolemy! Copernicus! Right, an open letter to Copernicus. Dear Copernicus, why you always gotta make the rest of us look so bad? You were both a lawyer and a doctor? That doesn't seem fair. You spoke four languages and discovered that the Earth is not the center of the universe? Come on! But at least you didn't discover it entirely on your own. Now, there's no way to be sure that you had access to Muslim scholarship on this topic. But one of your diagrams is so similar to a proof found in an Islamic mathematics treatise that it's almost impossible you didn't have access to it. Even the letters on the diagram are almost the same, so at least I can tell my mom that when she asks why I'm not a doctor and a lawyer and the guy who discovered the heliocentric solar system. Best wishes, John Green. All right, so now having spent the last several minutes telling you why the Renaissance happened in Italy and not in, I don't know, like India or Russia or whatever, I'm going to argue that the Renaissance did not in fact happen. Let's start with the problem of time. The Renaissance isn't like the Battle of Hastings or the French Revolution where people were aware that they were living amid history. Like when I was 11 and most of you didn't exist yet, my dad made my brother and me turn off the Cosby Show and watch people climbing on the Berlin Wall so we could see history. But no one like woke their kids up in a Tuscan village in 1512 like, "Mario, Luigi, come outside, the Renaissance is here! Hurry, we're living in a glorious new era where man's relationship to learning is changing. I somehow feel a new sense of individualism based on my capacity for reason." No, in fact, most people in Europe were totally unaware of the Renaissance because its art and learning affected a tiny sliver of the European population. Like, life expectancy in many areas of Europe actually went down during the Renaissance. Art and learning of the Renaissance didn't filter down to most people the way that technology does today. And really, the Renaissance was only experienced by the richest of the rich and those people, like painters, who served them. I mean, there were some commercial opportunities, like for framing paintings or binding books, but the vast majority of Europeans still lived on farms either as free peasants or tenants. And the rediscovery of Aristotle didn't in any way change their lives, which were governed by the rising and setting of the sun and intellectually by the Catholic Church. In fact, probably about 95% of Europeans never encountered the Renaissance's opulence or art or modes of thought. We have constructed the Renaissance as important not because it was so central to the 15th century. I mean, at the time, Europe wasn't the world's leader in anything other than the tiny business of Atlantic trade. We remember it as important because it matters to us now. It gave us the Ninja Turtles. We care about Aristotle and individualism and the Mona Lisa and the possibility that Michelangelo painted an anatomically correct brain onto the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel because these things give us a narrative that makes sense. Europe was enlightened, and then it was unenlightened, and then it was re-enlightened, and ever since it's been the center of art and commerce and history. See that cycle of life and death and rebirth a lot in historical recollection, but it just isn't accurate. So it's true that many of the ideas introduced to Europe in the 15th and 16th centuries became very important. But remember, when we talk about the Renaissance, we're talking about hundreds of years. I mean, although they share Ninja Turtledom, Donatello and Raphael were born 97 years apart. And the Renaissance humanist Petrarch was born in 1304, 229 years before the Renaissance humanist Montaigne. That's almost as long as the United States has existed. So was the Renaissance a thing? Not really. It was a lot of mutually interdependent things that occurred over centuries. Stupid truth, always resisting simplicity. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next week. Crash Course is produced and directed by Stan Muller. Our script supervisor is Danica Johnson. The show is written by my high school history teacher, Raoul Meyer, and myself, and our graphics team is Thought Bubble.
Anyway, there you go. Normally, I wouldn't show so much history, and for heaven's sakes, we talked about astronomy with Copernicus, but the Renaissance is especially interesting in terms of the history, besides the art and the politics and the economics and everything. And I just wanted to point out, because you don't get a sense of it in the book, that they're talking about how the humanists, who are about to, we'll discuss them in a second as well, they were rediscovering ancient Greek and Roman text. Well, the fact is that Islamic texts were also extremely important, and that's given pretty short shrift in the textbook. So I just wanted to point that out. And also, the point that he made at the end, I can't emphasize enough. He's talking about the narrative. So there's a narrative, the Renaissance came, it changed everybody's lives. You know, that's not true at all. So he's exaggerating the point by saying, was there a Renaissance? Well, of course there was. We made the Renaissance hundreds of years afterwards, and everybody else now enjoys it. But it was a good little excursion. Anyway, so can we look at that introductory slide? Today we're going to talk about the Renaissance. We're going to talk about three parts of the Renaissance. There's an Italian Renaissance. Okay, now that's question of the day. That introduction, well anyway, it doesn't matter. There's the early Renaissance and the high Renaissance in Italy. There we go. There's the Renaissance in the north, and there's the late Renaissance. And so even though you guys might think that the Renaissance was an Italian thing, it definitely wasn't. It most definitely wasn't. And if we have time, I'm going to show you some videos. Most of the videos today are going to be about Northern Renaissance stuff, because my hunch is you guys at least have a cultural consciousness of Michelangelo, Da Vinci, artists like that, but you don't know about Hans Holbein and those artists. But anyway, we're going to discuss some terms for the chapter. These are terms from the book. Oil painting was, if not invented, it was perfected. And there's two particular techniques called sfumato and chiaroscuro. Those are Leonardo da Vinci techniques. We're going to look at them. We're going to look at linear and atmospheric perspective. That is a Southern Renaissance element. We're going to look at what a humanist is. We're going to look at Plato, and he's the guy that wrote Plato's Republic, ancient Greek, hung out in the Acropolis. And we're going to talk about Neoplatonism, which is a hybrid revival of Plato. We're going to talk about the Medicis, biggest patrons, politicians. I think one became Pope. We're going to talk about the Academy. It's not an acting thing. It's where humanists used to hang out. And we're going to talk about Mannerism, which is a style. These artists, it was actually called Mannerism at the time, and it came at the end of the Italian Renaissance. Very interesting stuff, and it provides a nice little bridge into what we're going to talk about next week, which is going to be Baroque. As I said, when you talk about the Renaissance, typically you think Italy, and rightly so. Unbelievable stuff happened there. One of the reasons that's where the term Renaissance man came from. You had Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo, and they were Renaissance men. They weren't just artists. They were engineers, they were architects, they were scientists. They did everything. And not only did they do everything, they weren't amateurs at it. They were staggeringly brilliant at every single thing they did. The Renaissance that we're going to talk about art historically, the video he was kind of jumping from late Middle Ages to 16th century. Renaissance we're going to talk about goes from about 1400 to 1600. If you didn't know this already, Renaissance means rebirth. That was a conscious thing. The term refers to the interest in ancient Greek and Roman sculpture, and perhaps even more significantly, to the ruins. So they had, if you lived in Italy, if you lived in Rome, if you lived in Venice, there were the ruins of the buildings, the architecture that hadn't been destroyed during the Christian Dark Ages. That interest in Greek and Roman culture, ancient Greek and Roman culture, that's one of the key characteristics of the period. So is the fact that the nude reappeared. You don't see the nude in Middle Age art because the nude was in churches. The artists of the Renaissance, they believed in God. They also believed in Plato, as we'll discuss shortly. But they believed that man is God's greatest creation, and therefore, why not show man in all his glory, in all his or her physical glory? And in my opinion, the biggest change in the transition from artists to from the Middle Ages to that we discussed last week to the artist of the Renaissance is you don't necessarily art, and this is not to be impious or iconoclastic, but it's not so much that artists were not serving God anymore, but it's that they were soaring to find their highest individual potential. It went from working subservient as anonymous craftsmen to trying to be as brilliant as you possibly can, given your God-given talents. There was a new rich merchant class that joined the nobility as art patrons. And the big change is now, up till now, we had the church as a huge patron, and we had nobility as a huge patron. They're still extremely significant, but they also became the merchant class, as we saw in the video, because of all the trade and the construction and the banking that the Renaissance was dealing with. A lot of people had a lot of money. A lot of these people wanted to show off how wealthy and powerful they were by commissioning work, and that's where some of the greatest work ever done has come from. The artist status changed, and one of the interesting things is I mentioned a second ago that they were anonymous people. We don't know who. I don't think hardly any of these Middle Ages artists were. These artists, the Renaissance artists, they were very smart. They were very educated. They had creative powers, and people would think that they were godlike because they had these creative powers. They could make things. They could explain things. They were considered a breed apart because of their ability, and they transcended social classes. Painting, sculpture, and architecture were held as intellectual activities allied with mathematics, science, and poetry. So in other words, the liberal studies that they had in ancient Greece, to that has now been added the art of creativity, which I think is extremely interesting. And it's one of the reasons why artists would walk around so arrogant and so interesting. Paris Richardson writes something, and the answer is no, I didn't know that. But Paris Richardson writes, thank you, Paris, did you know that the person in the Crash Course video is the author of the novel, The Fault in Our Stars, that is now a major motion picture? First of all, is that out right now? Because I haven't heard of that. And another novel, which is becoming a movie right now. I didn't know that at all. I just knew him as a Crash Course guy. Thanks, Paris. If you want to just write back real quick, are these fictional movies? Are these historical? Are they historical dramas? Are they documentaries? Anyway, excellent. Thank you. All right, so one of the things that came out of the study of Greece, of ancient Greece, was the scholars started studying Plato. Plato had sort of pretty much disappeared during the Middle Ages. I'm jumping over centuries, and a lot of this is just very general stuff, but again, we're creating a narrative of the transition from the Middle Ages to the Renaissance. So the Renaissance is literally playing hopscotch by going backwards to ancient Greece and Rome. Okay, so influenced by Plato, beauty became equated with moral goodness. And so therefore, it's no big leap of the imagination. From there, from this idea of moral goodness, Renaissance artists became interested in seeking idealized beauty, not just a picture of the way that somebody actually looked in real life. Maybe they got a big nose, maybe they got funny hair, whatever. They make them perfect based on perfect proportions. So you're looking at a portrait of a pope, for instance, or somebody, and he's got some kind of an acne scar or a smallpox scar on his neck or whatever. Well, the artist isn't going to put that in. So as I said before, as a result, humankind was viewed as God's finest and the most perfect creation. And reason and creativity were considered God's gifts as well. I think the point you're seeing here is these artists didn't put themselves on a level with their Christian God. They were simply celebrating the gifts they felt that this Christian God, this particular Christian God, had given them. And we're going to see what happened when that came head on, that collided head on with ancient Greece and ancient Rome. Artists of the Renaissance, their biggest attempt was, what they tried the hardest to do, and they did it absolutely brilliantly, the artist in the South in one general way, the artist in the North in a general way, was to reproduce the natural world as accurately as possible. You've seen these medieval images we've looked at. You've seen the prehistorical ones we looked at last week. They were, let's call them likenesses. We've seen the cave paintings. They give you a general idea. Okay, this is a buffalo, this is a tree, this is somebody with a spear, this is somebody holding a child. It could be anybody. They're not trying to capture a particular idealized likeness. They just want, they want to make it as real as they possibly can. They studied all sorts of things. They studied light. It's hard to say who actually invented chiaroscuro, but Leonardo certainly perfected it. The word is a combination, it's from the Italian, it's light and dark, and you can model things. You can model shapes, especially with drawings and paintings, by using a combination of light and dark. So things seem to be three-dimensional when you're using light and dark to show the edges of things or the roundness of things. They also noticed that when you're looking at something far away, like if you're looking down, say you're looking down the street, a long street, and you're looking at, just pretend you're looking at 25 school buses just going down the street, you notice the one in front of you is going to be mammoth, and you're going to notice that the, in fact we can do it here, so the street is like this, and you'll notice that the biggest bus is right there, and this next one, and the next one, and the next one, and the next one. And it gets really small up there. So what they noticed is things appear smaller. Distant things appear smaller than near ones. And they developed a system of linear perspective. It's based on mathematics. They also saw, because they're studying atmosphere and how things exist in space, one way to put objects in pictorial space that's meant to simulate real space, the space we live in, is a atmospheric perspective, which is different than linear perspective. They saw how detail and color would blur with distance, and they developed the principles of this atmospheric perspective. And we're going to look at a really excellent example of that in a Leonardo, it's very well known. It's not one of his most famous paintings, but one of Da Vinci's paintings, St. Anne and the Virgin. Artists studied anatomy. They were Renaissance. They weren't necessarily doctors, but they were certainly curious, and Leonardo was incredibly curious. They would even dissect cadavers, and they didn't do it just for a morbid curiosity. They sincerely, truly wanted to understand the nature of the human form. And as we're going to see, what they saw by cutting open a body and scientifically examining the body, they saw how muscles work, how bones work, how tendons, ligaments, and all the connective tissue works. And that has a very extremely significant impact on sculpture that we're going to look at in just a second. First, we're going to talk about the early Renaissance artists in the early 1500s. These were artists that included Donatello. No, he's not that. Whatever that TV show was. Architect named Ghiberti, this absolutely fantastic painter named Masaccio, and Botticelli, Ninja Turtle. Donatello, can we see the image of St. Mark, please? Donatello was a sculptor, and he used the body as the framework on which the fabric draped. So in other words, even though he's sitting in dark space, he's sitting in a space, you can still walk around him. But what's far more interesting is, instead of being interested, as the Greeks were, on the folds of the drapery and stuff, he's got him here. His knee is bent, okay? I don't know if you can tell that, but the knee's bent. So if the knee bends, that means the cloth around it is going to hang in a different way than that close to it. And sure enough, it does as the knee bends. So in other words, the achievement of Donatello, and this all kind of seems obvious now, but at the time, as you've seen from the statues we saw at Chartres Cathedral last week, there was no interest in showing the underlying structure of the human body. The way they would do this is they would create a full-scale clay model of a nude figure. Then they would soak linen, because it absorbed the material but could still be draped over things. They would soak it in clay over the clay model to form the garments. And then that model was later copied in marble. I still maintain my own personal opinion. Marble sculpture is the most miraculous thing that I could ever imagine. Even more than the lost bronze technique for making, lost wax technique for making bronze sculpture. I cannot believe how you can make anything out of, on a large scale, out of marble. There's an architect in the early Renaissance named Lorenzo Ghiberti. Could we see the baptistry doors, please, the image? These doors were, there was a cathedral, a huge cathedral in Florence. And his innovation was he actually used architecture so you've got the figures, right? You've got figures right there, and there's a narrative here. It's a biblical story, but we're not going to get into that right now. But he has set them in architecture that, unlike anything we've seen from the Middle Ages, we kind of saw it with Duccio and Giotto as a review at the start of class today. They're actually existing in a space where they're proportionate to the architecture. In other words, you might be looking at a Middle Ages sculpture or something, and the figures are going to be that tall, and the huge building is going to be that tall. Again, it seems kind of obvious right now, but major, major accomplishment at the time. Masaccio, I've seen a bunch of his work in Florence, and he's my favorite. It's like looking, well, it's, you're looking, it seems really new, incredibly new, even though this was done like 600, 700 years ago. He used this new technique, and literally it had just been developed and used by artists, of linear perspective. Can we see the Trinity, the Holy Trinity, please? And what he did, he created this deep, convincing architectural space with his work. So first of all, he used the triangle composition, which is a symbol of the Godhead. Okay, so there's God up here, the figure is right there, and you can't see it. It looks like part of maybe God's collar. It's not. That's actually a dove of Christ. But there's actually a space. You get this impression of a very deep space, and there's a perspective line that goes like that, and it goes back into the space. They've preserved it perfectly. It's an absolutely gorgeous piece, absolutely gorgeous piece. There's this architect named Leon Battista Alberti. Can we see the San Andrea Church in Mantua? This is, what is very cool about this is the fact that it's based on Roman models. It's got the columns, it's got the use of the space, but it's also, it's got the barrel vault. It's also got it's got these Renaissance flourishes. It's got these, you can see the perspective, and this is walking down the nave, down the center, and everything goes in like that. You can't see it, but there's these, they're called transepts. So spaces that go off into it this way. So if you could peel off the roof of that thing and look at it, you would see they would have these incredible rhythms full of, based on these geometric volumes. So it was mathematically based. It was not a ripoff or a knockoff of Roman sculpture, but it was an embellishment of it. They took it and they ran with it. Botticelli was an early Renaissance painter. Could we see the Birth of Venus, please? He worked for the Medici family, who we'll discuss in just a second. We have a large-scale nude. As I said, the nude is back in circulation. And what we have is we have, it combines, the piece combines Christian, Greek, and Roman themes. Roman themes is significant here. It's, I mean, the fact that they're combining all of them. And the Medicis commissioned the piece. The Medicis were a wealthy merchant class family who were art patrons. They're also, and I mean, there's all these great stories about them, and I don't know how many of them are true. It's said that if you lived at the time, that it's very conceivable that they were the godfathers of the Florentine Renaissance. There's all sorts of interesting stuff there. They sponsored an academy. An academy is a discussion group. It's where people get together, they debate ideas, very interesting stuff. It's where humanist scholars and artists met to discuss classical culture and its relationship to Christianity. So again, humanism was the combination of ideas and concepts and beliefs and themes and figures and narratives and legends from the Bible combined with those of classical Greece and classical Rome. When you combine these two systems of thought, you had a philosophy known as Neoplatonism. Yeah, we're not going to see the video of the doors. Sorry, thank you. That's to the aside. Thank you, Paris. Paris writes in response to my question, John Green is an author who writes teen fiction and chick lit. The written chick lit? That's gum. Chick lit. Oh, chick literature? Sorry. He also has a brother, Hank Green, with whom he has a video blog for nerds. I love it. Chick lit and a vlog. A chick lit. Okay, great. Thank you. I now know that. Thank you, Paris. Appreciate that. All right. We are now in the High Renaissance. We're getting into the 16th century. It lasted about 25 years. It ended about, these are approximate, but just to give you a sense of proportion here, it ended about 1520. The two major figures, not just artists, but figures of the High Renaissance are Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci. Other well-known artists include Raphael, Titian, and Giorgione. Da Vinci is the prototypical representation of the Renaissance man. Many people consider him to be the greatest genius that ever lived. After all, he was a painter, a sculptor, a musician, an architect, an engineer, a science, and a musician. And he wasn't just mediocre at these things. He was absolutely stunning at all of them. He left many works unfinished, which is a shame. What's also a shame, perhaps a bigger shame, one of the things that he liked to do was experiment with techniques. So, among artistic techniques, so when he painted the Last Supper, he's painting, it's plaster, it's on a wet wall. Well, he did not preserve that wall very well. And apparently, And this was 600, many centuries ago. It kind of started falling apart even at the time. So we can say that he did many brilliant things, but perhaps a lot of his work like this were meant to be left for posterity, but they weren't necessarily. We've looked at these two images before. The two most famous images are the Mona Lisa. Can we see that, please? Very briefly. Mona Lisa. It's in that King Cole. It's coming. The Mona Lisa is coming. Well, you guys know what the Mona Lisa looks like. And you know what the Last Supper looks like, too. So it's been restored many times because, as I mentioned, it's been in disrepair. They do their best to take care of it. Anyway, there's a lovely image by Leonardo called Madonna and Child with Saint Anne. Might that be available? There we go. Thank you. And there's a word that I mentioned before. It's sfumato. It's the Italian word for smoke. And Leonardo was an absolute master at this. It's made by layering a bunch of translucent gazes. And what they do is they present hazy atmosphere and shadows and stuff. And it's part of the atmospheric perspective we were talking about. So we have, you know, the basic classical triangle right there. And they dominate the piece. But as you notice, things get fuzzier and edges get softer the back you go, further back you go in space. So a lot of it is, it's clear. These are like particular faces and everything. So as you go deeper, it gets hazier. You get even deeper, and it's just very misty. And so the implication being, you use that. He used that to a very great extent to show the recession in space. It's not based on linear perspective. There's nothing mathematical about it. It's pretty much purely intuitive. Michelangelo was 25 years younger than Da Vinci. He was also his biggest rival. And I don't know if they actually feuded. I don't know how things worked in those days. I do remember that Da Vinci left Florence because he wasn't getting a lot of commissions because of Michelangelo. So there was something going on, and he didn't like it, and he left. Anyway, he was a painter, a sculptor, a poet. And finally, there we have the Mona Lisa. What's funny is he considered himself a sculptor above all else. It's very funny because he considered him a sculptor above all else, but it's kind of ironic because he wasn't just a sculptor, he was an architect, he was a master draftsman. We look at his David. Do we have his David here we can look at real quick? There. Okay, so it's pretty clear. I mean, it's classical. It's a very classical-based sculpture. But what's very unclassical about it is he's poised. It's like he's about to do something. He's turned, he's twisted, he's got one foot kind of off the ground, and he's got this very poised, serene, and yet expression on his face, which is, it's got tension and energy in it. So it's classical, but it goes a lot more than classical. You know, I've pitched this before, and I will take, you guys can call in or you guys can email in. I shared this, I had a discussion with one of the students in this class, I think after the first lecture. She asked me my opinion of why the Mona Lisa was smiling. If you guys have any interesting ideas, as off the wall as you might think, bring them in, we can look at it, because clearly she's smiling at something. That's not a typical smile. But anyway, okay, let's look at the Sistine Chapel. This is his masterpiece. Michelangelo's masterpiece. We still have Leonardo. Oh, here it is. Now, you guys have heard of this. Looking at this is just kind of ludicrous because you have no perception of what this is actually about. It took him 4 years to do it. He was 68 feet off the ground for 4 years. He's working in very cramped, claustrophobic a space. It's a fresco. So he's working on wet on wet. So you can imagine the physical effort to do this for 4 years. And it's, I don't know what sort of a, you know, shop assistance he might have had. It's got Old Testament stories of prophets and narratives. It's funny because, you know, he didn't like painting, and yet it's most possibly, well, I think it's fair to say that this is his biggest achievement. And it's one of those bucket list items, too. We're not going to look at the Sister Wendy video because we're running out of time. Can we look at another piece of architecture? He designed the St. Peter's Basilica in the Vatican. So if you can imagine, he's painted the interior of the Sistine Chapel, and then he's designed the new St. Peter's Basilica in the Vatican. I mean, Renaissance man, yep. Okay. We're going to go through three more artists, and then we're going to pose the second question of the day, and then we are going to take a break. If these three guys had lived in a time where these guys were all working at the same time. If they had lived in an era without Da Vinci and Michelangelo, I think we probably would have looked at them different as even more excellent than they were, and they are excellent. Raphael, we have an image of Pope Leo X with two cardinals. The two cardinals are actually, it's a fair representation of the Pope right there with his face. His two nephews are actually cardinals. It shows that he's a book collector. And if you look at this, the rich red material everywhere and everything that he's wearing, it's also kind of a symbol of the church at its material height. The church had Catholic Church, Roman Catholic Church, ton of money, and they weren't afraid to spend it, including on portraits of their popes. The two cities we've talked about so far in Venice, in Italy, are Florence and Rome. There was a third major center, and we looked at it in that video. It was the Center for Trade and Commerce, and that's Venice. There was an artist named Titian, and he did this Annunciation scene. Can we see that, please? And Annunciation, if you guys don't know this, it's a story where Mary gets knowledge from an angel that she is going to bear the Christ child via Immaculate Conception. And so it's a gorgeous piece. When he was younger, Titian was very dramatic. Big, broad colors, tight brush strokes, geometric compositions. As he got older, as shown here, his colors softened and his brush strokes became looser. And it's interesting, a contemporary of his told him once that if you stand up close, you can't really see what the image is of. And only when you pull back do you actually have a sense of what's going on. And that's interesting because that's exactly what they said about the Impressionist a couple centuries later. And then finally, Italian artist named Giorgione. We're going to look at an image of his called The Tempest. Now, the cool thing about this piece is, well, there's two things. First of all, art historians and other scholars do not have a clue what is going on. There's a woman right there nursing a child, and there's some guy there watching him nurse a child. But what art historians have said, and I think it's a very valid point, the focus is actually on the landscape. You'll notice they're off to the side. Your eye goes right up into this, and it goes into the beauty of the landscape. And as we'll see with the Northern Renaissance artists, landscape, without being religious, is going to become a very major theme of art. Can we see the second question of the day, please? It's coming up here in a second. There is a second question of the day, and I know it's coming. Unless I can find it. Okay. Question of the day number two. Okay. Why is the human figure so important to the Renaissance? What ideals were expressed through depictions of the human body? In other words, why all of a sudden is the human body been rediscovered? And this isn't just for religious portraits, it's for pictures of merchants and as we'll see, peasants too. And this is a question you can answer out of your head, you know, why do you think it would be like that? Or you can reflect on it after hearing the rest of this lecture and having read the chapter. Anyway, we're going to take a 5-minute break. Thank you. See you soon. Bye.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. Want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
Hi, my name is Mar Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, Watch, listen, learn DHTV. You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, folks. Welcome back to the second part of our discussion of the Renaissance. We've talked about the early Renaissance. We've talked about the High Renaissance. The High Renaissance had artists like Michelangelo and Da Vinci and Raphael and Titian and all those guys. Now, we are going to talk about the Northern Renaissance. And it'll include Germany, Holland, Belgium, Switzerland. In other words, not Italy, not the South. And it evolved out of the Middle Ages. And here's the second question of the day again. Why is the human figure so important to the Renaissance? What ideas were expressed through depictions of the human body? So why is everybody focused in the Renaissance on the human body? We talked about it briefly. The nude made a reappearance, but there's a lot of ideas going on, and they're not just religious ideas. So anyway, so we're talking about the art of the Northern Renaissance. It evolved out of the Middle Ages. It was focused to an incredible extent, and I might add an incredibly beautiful extent, on detail and observation of detail. The artist's interest in detail stems from a tradition of decorative art. This would include illuminated manuscripts, miniatures, which were small books, stained glass, and tapestry. Huge difference with the art of the Northern Renaissance. There were no ruins. There was no sense of heritage that they were trying to recover. As far as we know, there were no documents that had been lost and then rediscovered. They were interested in the precise outer appearance of their subjects. And though the book doesn't touch on it, it's also a time of the Protestant Reformation, which is, in my 5-second story, is it's a schism within Christianity led by, among others, Martin Luther and John Calvin. And it describes a good hunk of the history of the Renaissance and what came after for about 100 years. Religious artwork, the one interesting thing, and I find that it's not funny, I find it interesting, the religious artwork of the Northern Renaissance, however, tended to be incredibly more violent and harsh than that of the South, and we'll look at that at the end. We're going to look at a couple of artists. The Lamborg brothers, there were two, maybe three of them. We don't exactly know. There was Robert Campan, Roger van der Weyden, Matthias Grunewald, Hans Holbein the Younger. Can we have the image of the Lettres Richour? The Lamborg brothers made this incredible, incredible image of it's from a book of hours. It's a prayer book, and there's a calendar, and that's actually astrologically the month of February. So up here you got February, but down here you have this incredibly charming peasant scene. I'm sure that that's not meant to have a wall missing, but they've taken the wall off to show you the woman sitting inside, all warm. We've got somebody chopping wood. We've got somebody with a mule. And we got a church in the background. You can see, although you can't see it here, there's frost on that guy's breath right there. You can see individual, well, not individual snowflakes, but you can see the frost on the trees. Now, the detail in itself is absolutely astonishing. And it's said that that's a high point of medieval art in the Northern Renaissance. And of course, it all ended shortly thereafter with the invention of the printing press by Gutenberg, because you didn't need those things anymore. But to me, the most amazing thing is with this image, the details are exquisite. It's beautifully composed. If you can imagine this, that thing is 9 inches high. So that's the kind of detail they were working at on such a diminutive scale. Can we see the Meroud altarpiece, please? Robert Campan was another artist. He painted in oil. Oil had been, it's hard to go into detail about these things. Oil had been, if not invented, they were realizing that it was better to put oil into paint instead of tempura. It would dry bread better. As Da Vinci found, the work would preserve better for future generations. But perhaps more to the point, you could also achieve unbelievably realistic effects with oil paint. With this piece, it's an Annunciation again, as we saw before. You can't really see it, but there's an angel coming in to tell Mary that she's going to bear the Christ child. Okay. Now, what's interesting about this is even though it's called Renaissance art, there's not a lick of linear perspective. It's all painted. And there's three parts to it, actually. This is the center part of the triptych. It's painted kind of with intuitive perception. But what I find interesting are the details and the reflection of the light in the clothing. And you look at a bunch of these faces of medieval art, of Italian and Northern Renaissance art, and these faces all seem the same. These faces are insanely beautiful. And I bet they're of a particular person. Now, you can't see it, but this is a triptych, which means there's three parts of it. Over here is this very interesting image, and it represents Joseph. Joseph is the future wife of Mary and the father of the immaculately conceived Christ child, and he is making a mousetrap. And if you don't know why he's making a mousetrap, it was said that the mousetrap would help him catch a mouse, just as Christ would confound the devil. So there's some symbolism working there, which is very interesting. We have Roger van der Weyden. Could we please see St. Luke drawing the Virgin? This is an interesting piece, and I think the book makes a very compelling argument about it. It says that the piece is about looking. So it is about looking, okay? St. Luke, this guy, is drawing a picture of the Virgin and child. These two people out on the parapet are outside looking down the river. We are looking there, we're looking there, and we're looking there. So it is indeed the theme. A possible theme is about looking, but it's also about the details that you're looking at while you're gazing at it. The details are incredible, as are all these pieces here. We're going to see a picture by Matthias Grunewald from the Eisenheim altarpiece. And remember I had said that a lot of the religious art is a lot more harsh than that of the South, and it sure is here. Now, we don't have a close-up on it, but the Christ figure he's never in good shape on a crucifix, but if we had close-ups of the feet and the hands, it's maybe just as well that we don't, because they're absolutely horrible. Now, obviously, it's meant to show the suffering, the man of sorrows as he's been crucified. Now, what's interesting is, and again, you look at art, one of the ways we now look at art is in terms of context. And this piece, this crucifixion piece, originally hung in a hospital for people with syphilis, okay? So perhaps that gives us a sense of why the hands and the feet are particularly gruesome here. Hans Holbein the Younger, that presumes there's a Hans Holbein the Elder, but Hans Holbein the Younger painted a picture called The Ambassadors. This is actually a very famous painting. It's in the National Gallery in London. It's incredibly gorgeous to look at. And he's an interesting guy because he's one of those transition figures in Northern Renaissance art, because it's clear that he's got the details nailed, all the patterns on the rugs and stuff, the fur or the ermine, the shadows, the hat, the everything. But he's also showing these bodies, and these bodies are clearly not skeletons. There's meat on these bones, and we can see that the clothing drapes the way that the bodies are positioned. There's all these interesting symbols in here. One is these carpets are Persian carpets, and as we saw in the video, there was a lot of trade going on with the Ottoman Empire. We see references to music, arithmetic, geometry, and astronomy. You can't see the detail. This is a lute, in case you guys didn't know it. There's a broken string on that lute, and it was on purpose. It was meant to show the discord of Europe at the time because of the Protestant Reformation. There was literally a war within the Catholic Church, and the various branches came afterwards. But this is all going on at the time. Now, what's really interesting about this piece, and I don't even know if you can kind of see it here, it's very odd, and I don't know why he did it this way. Okay, guys, you see that thing? If you look at it straight on, I don't know what it looks like. If you look at it from the side, it's actually a skull, okay? So that's a skull. And it also belongs there. It was put there on purpose because the ambassador's motto, the French ambassador's motto was, remember, you must die. So as we saw with the image of Raphael's Pope Leo X and the sumptuousness and the wealth and everything, so too are we looking at the incredible wealth of these merchants, these ambassadors, and this church figure, but also the awareness of the fact that all of it is fleeting and everybody is going to die at some point. There's an image by Peter Bruegel, the Elder. It's called The Harvesters, thank you. And the book, again, says, and it's a good way to look at it, the way the book set this into context as well, because what it says is this image is a great example of the Protestant, the effect of art the effect of the Protestant Reformation on art, because what you have is the Protestants believed, and I wish that we could do a whole lecture just on that alone. The Protestants believed that any sort of depictions of saints and martyrs and, you know, virgins and Christ childs and gods and heavens and hells, that was all blasphemy. So they strongly, strongly discouraged that. They called it idol worship. So instead, what artists did, to very, very great and very influential effect, they turned to the natural world. So we've talked in general about how Northern Renaissance artists are interested in details. They're looking at details of, you know, the frost on somebody's beard or the ice breath coming out of somebody's mouth outside. But Bruegel takes it to a whole new level, because this whole painting is about being outside, especially about being in the landscape. It's a totally gorgeous painting. It's lunchtime. He's taking a nap. These guys are eating. He's coming in for lunch, probably. You've got these gorgeous shapes of uncut grass, and this is clearly the path that they're making. You've got the bundles of grass right there. You've got the tree, and then you've got that atmospheric perspective that we saw in Da Vinci's image of St. Anne. The further back you go, the more hazy it is, okay, which is interesting. Now, if you look at this in terms of the composition, if you look at it formally, just using your eyes, and we've done that before, it's what we do when we take a walk, your eye does not go that way and it doesn't focus on these guys, your eye comes in and it might go up the tree and go shooting out into the space. But the fact of the matter is, the theme of this work is nature, and in particular, it's about landscape. And the Bruegel's interpretation of the theme is people are in sync with the rhythms of nature. They follow the seasons, and that's it. It's a gorgeous painting. It's also full of symbolism. And, you know, you could argue it's one of the first landscape paintings that's about landscape. Nothing religious about that at all. Okay, now we're at the end of the Renaissance. It's called late Renaissance. There's a style called Mannerism, and it's actually a very interesting style. And if you're interested, just go Google Mannerism, and I'm going to give you a couple of names of artists, and you can see some really, really extraordinary images. They're supercharged images. What they are, scholars date the end of the High Renaissance, the beginning of the late Renaissance, with the death of Raphael in 1520. After that came what scholars called Mannerism, which is from the Italian word maniera, which means style or stylishness. So in other words, it was a conscious embellishment of style. The artwork was influenced significantly by the late artwork of Michelangelo. And the late artwork, which we don't have time to look at today, but the late artwork of Michelangelo was very powerful, very colorful. I mentioned this before, by the way, but it's an amazing story. They thought that he was a dark, melancholy person. They cleaned the Sistine Chapel. These images are bright like Easter colors. Anyway, so this art was part of the Counter-Reformation. So the Protestant Reformation was the Protestants breaking away from the papacy and Rome. Well, the Rome and the Pope aren't just going to sit around. They commissioned artists to paint work that strictly adhered to church's teaching and to engage the viewers' hearts and minds of the faithful. So we have an image by N'Golo Bronzino called Allegory. And very strange image. Nobody knows exactly what it is. It's Venus, Cupid, Folly, and Time. It has obscure references, which this most certainly does. It has erotic undercurrents. It has elongated figures, S-shaped people, and a crowded, illegible space. The logic makes no sense in that image. Finally, we have an image by Tintoretto called The Last Supper. It shows late Titian's influence. The brushstroke is wild. The lighting is wild. If you can remember what Da Vinci's look like, this is incredibly staged. It's got this incredibly powerful light, okay, coming in. It's got light and dark. It's got this extremely vivid diagonal composition. It's powerful. It's significant. We've looked at the Renaissance in the North and the South. Next week, we are going to look at 17th and 18th century art. Any questions about the art paper? Let me know. Write to me, please. Everybody have a good weekend. Thank you.